Amen. I got to know our guest today some years back in 1999. I've known him way longer. That's 1999. Some people were not born 1999. Yeah. 1999 is a lot. How many years is that? 35. Is it 35? 25 years ago. Yeah, it should be about that. Yeah. Where were you 25 years ago? If you remember 25 years from your age, well. So he has been serving God before then. Before then. Preaching and teaching God's word. And like fine wine, each time we see him, he looks younger. Looks younger by the grace of God. Please do me a favor. The Bible says he that receives a prophet in the name of a prophet shall get a prophet's reward. Would you like to receive today for the first time in Virtuous Christian Center, among many other times, our special guest, Reverend Adetokunba Adejumo. Let's give him a big round of applause as he brings us God's word. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you so much. Praise the Lord. Let's please be seated. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you so much. Well, I'd like to start by saying a very big thank you to Pastor Alex and his wonderful wife. The privilege afforded me to be here today. I love the warmth. I love the way he connects with his people. You know, there's just something about a pastor. When a pastor is talking to his people, you know, a pastor is different. A guest minister, he just will come, he'll be gone in a short while. But the pastor stays. Na ebano, with full ground. Amen. So just the way he was just sharing from his heart, the love he has for you, how he wants your life to move ahead, those things are always a blessing. I'm always thrilled when I see that. And those are things that when someone is like that, it always tells. Thank you so much for the privilege. Well, the theme of the meeting is finishing strong, finishing strong. And I like to take my text from the book of Ecclesiastes. Ecclesiastes chapter 7. We'll read a verse there and take it as our text. Verse 8. The first part of the verse is where I want to call our attention to. But let's read the entire verse. It says, better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. And the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. Heavenly Father, we thank you because you're our Father and you're a good Father. Thank you for once again another opportunity this morning for us to fellowship with you and fellowship with one another. As we approach your word, we do it humbly and reverently. We trust that by your spirit, you will unveil, unfold, and reveal the word of God to our spirits. We won't be hearers of the word alone, but we'll be doers of the same. And as a result, full recipients of all of your blessings. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' matchless name we pray, and everybody said, yeah. Amen. So here where we read, the Bible says, better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. Yeah, God likes good beginnings. We see Genesis chapter 1, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. You know, John 1 from verse 1, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. So yes, it's a God of beginnings. But it's not just a God of beginnings, a God of endings as well. A God of finishings as well. And God wants us to finish and to finish strong. Because the end of a thing is better than the beginning thereof. Now, Carl Lewis was a sprinter. He didn't have quite a good start, but he always finished strong. And there's just something about how you finish. You know, the Bible lets us know in Job chapter 8 and in verse 7, it says, though your beginning be small, it says your latter end shall greatly increase. We see in Zechariah chapter 4 and in verse 10, where the Bible tells us not to despise the day of little beginnings or small beginnings. Yes, no matter how you may have begun, maybe you weren't born with a silver spoon in your mouth. Maybe you struggled through life. You began on a bad footing. Listen, however you started is not as important as how you finish. And God wants us to finish and to finish strong. Now in the Bible, we notice that there were some people who finished strong. Some examples of such people. The Lord Jesus. Remember he said in John chapter 4 verse 34. When he was by the well in Sychar. Disciples had gone to look for food. He was tired. He was hungry. But he still seized the opportunity when he met that woman by the well to witness to her. And disciples came and said, how come? You know, have you eaten something? You're going strong. You're still preaching. How are you able to do that? Jesus told them, he said, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. So he said, what I feed on, what makes me tick, what excites me, what gets me moving is to finish his work, to do his will. So Jesus was about the Father's will. And he said his desire, his passion, his drive was to do that will and to finish it. Now, question, did Jesus finish it? In John chapter 17, verse 4, he said, I've finished the work that you gave me. So Jesus finished the plan and the purpose of God for him in his earth work. He completed it. On the cross in John 19:30, he said there, it is finished. Well, that was when the old covenant was finished. He fulfilled it. He set it aside. He also finished his work. In heaven today, he's seated at the right hand of the Father. Why is he seated? Because he finished. So Jesus, our perfect example, wasn't just a starter. He was also a finisher. And he didn't just finish anyhow, wishy-washy finish. He finished strong. He finished well. He finished completely. So Jesus was a finisher, a good finisher, a strong finisher too. Well, who else do we know who was a finisher? Paul was a finisher. In Acts chapter 20, from verse 22 through to 24, Paul said something, said, I go bound in the spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing what will befall me, save or except that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every place that bonds and afflictions abide me. He said, but none of these things move me. Neither count I my life as dear unto myself, that I may finish my course with joy, to testify of the gospel of the grace of God. So Paul said, look, I'm told that there's trouble ahead. I have that witness in my own spirit. Some other people did testify to that as well. But he said, look, I'm ready. No matter what it is, I'm going to finish my assignment. I'm going to finish my course. And I'm not just going to finish. I'm going to finish with joy. I'm going to finish strong. I'm going to testify of the gospel of the grace of God. So that was Paul's driving pressure, passion. Now, did Paul finish? Well, the last book he wrote was 2 Timothy in chapter 4, from verse 6 to verse 8. He said something. He said, the time of my departure is at hand. So before he died, he knew, yeah, I'm good to go now. I've finished. He said, I've fought a good fight. I've kept the faith. I have finished my course. He said, henceforth, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give to me, and not to me only on that day, but to them also that love his appearing. So Paul was a finisher, and he finished strong. He finished well. He fought a good fight. So it was a good fight. That was a good finish. Amen. He kept the faith. And when it was time to die, whoa, he left with a bang. Amen. That's how to go. So that's another example of somebody who finished and who finished strong. Well, do we have other people who finished in the Bible? Yes, we do. John the Baptist, we're told of him in Acts 13. That he finished. Acts 13. John the Baptist finished in verse 26. He finished. He finished his course. He fulfilled the plan of God. Well, who else do we know? 25, 26. Who else do we know that finished? Well, David in Acts 13, 22. God said about David that I found David, a man after my own heart, who will fulfill all my will. And later on in that chapter, verse 36, he said he served his generation after the will of God. So David also was someone who finished. So we see there's something about finishing. And we have examples of people who finished. Well, this is another year, 2024. This year is finishing too. But you know, it's not just God's plan for your life in the big sense that you ought to finish strong. You can finish this year strong. In Psalm 65 and in verse 11, the Bible tells us that God crowns our year with his goodness. And he causes his parts to drop fatness, to drop oil. You're dripping oil. You're dripping abundance. Amen. So God wants to crown our year. The year is not over yet. There are still 30 more days. And it doesn't take God forever to do a miracle. He created the whole universe in 6 days. 30 days are long enough for God to still do so much. So listen, God wants you to finish and to finish strong. He has a plan for your life. He has a purpose for your life. He wants you to fulfill it and to be able to finish it completely and finish strong. Not just finish and make it by the skin of your teeth. Oh, I just managed to finish. You know, some people finish a race and faint. Yeah, they finish, but that wasn't strong. You know, some people finish, you know, and they say, you got more. You know, they finish a marathon. Is that the end? It's just 10 kilometers. Do you have another kilometer? Amen. That's a good finish. God wants us to finish and to finish well, to finish strong. Finish the year and finish it strong. However, you know, the thing is this. Just telling me what is good, and I like it. But I love to know how. I love to know how. So, yes, he wants us to finish. Why does he want us to finish? He brings him glory. We're able to be a greater blessing to others. We're also the blessed for it. But the thing is this. How? How can I finish strong? How can I finish this year well? How can I still get everything God has for me for this year? How can I finish the plan and the purpose of God for my life? You see, as a rule, I make sure anything I start, I finish. If I pick a book to read, I make sure I finish it. If I start eating food, I make sure I finish it. If anything, you know why? If you get used to starting things and not finishing them, that same attitude may carry into other areas of your life. Until if you're not careful, you finish the plan, you start the plan of God for your life and not finish it. But if you are a finisher, you are habitually a finisher. Anything you start, you finish. You embark on a project, you see through to the end. You set out to do something, you see through to the end. That you always see to it that you finish. Your life will be that way. And then people will say, you see, that guy is going to finish. And he's going to finish strong. So, how do I finish strong? How do I finish strong? You know? Four things I believe the Lord laid on my heart. I prayed about this. I asked Pastor what he had in his heart, you know, for this service for God's people. You know, he's the under shepherd here. Jesus is the chief shepherd. And he's the one God will tell. He's the one God will talk to. I'm a guest. I'm here to strengthen the work. I'm here to come alongside the great work he's already doing. And so I asked him, what do you sense in your heart? What would you want me to emphasize? And he shared a few things with me. And I prayed along those same lines. And four things I felt the Lord will have me emphasize. Now, number one, if you're going to finish strong, if you're going to complete the plan of God or finish anything, you know, finish the year with a bang, finish the year well, run your race, finish your college education, your university education, finish anything, your career, end it and end it well. If you're going to finish, you must live by faith. You must live by faith. You must live by faith. You notice when Paul was talking in 2 Timothy 4 and in verse 7, he said, I've fought a good fight. I've finished my course. And then he said, I've kept the faith. So it was like a sandwich. When he was talking about him finishing, we saw two things that surrounded it. One was the fact that he fought a good fight. The other was the fact that he kept the faith. Now, obviously, that he kept the faith meant he continued to walk in faith. He stayed in faith. When he said he fought a good fight, what good fight did he fight? Well, there's only one good fight. 1 Timothy 6:12 says, fight the good fight of faith. Amen. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life. Whereunto thou art also called and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. So you see, what enabled him to finish his course was that he walked in faith. He fought the fight of faith. He kept the faith. So faith is vital to finishing your course. Faith is vital to running your race. In Habakkuk chapter 2 and in verse 4, the Bible says something. It says, the just, his soul which is lifted up is not upright in him. It says, but the just shall live by his faith. That's the first time we see that in the Bible, that the just shall live by his faith. Now, Paul referred to the same thing in Romans 1, in verse 16 and in verse 17. It says, so I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. So he said that again, right there, Romans 1:17, that the just shall live by faith. Galatians 3:11, by the works of the law shall no man be justified, for the just shall live by faith. Then in Hebrews 10, verse 38, it says, now the just shall live by faith, and if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. So, in Romans 1:17, Paul was talking about living by faith. That was his thesis on righteousness. He was bringing forth the truth of the word of God about righteousness, teaching it to the church at Rome and for the church of all time. So, kind of like in this Christian life, it's a life of faith. When one was talking to the Galatian Christians, those are folks that have been walking with God. They started well, but along the line, they began to get into legalism. And Paul was trying to tell them, stop that rubbish. Stop being foolish. Don't go into the law. Now, in talking to the Hebrew Christians, the writer of Hebrews, who many believe to be Paul, because it is his language, it fits into the Pauline revelation like a jigsaw puzzle. He said this there. He said, now his soul, which is the just shall live by faith. And if any man draw back. So the context in Hebrews was about not drawing back. Yes, was about finishing, staying true to the end. See, those folks, they were being pressured to go back to Judaism. So Paul was trying to tell them, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't draw back. Stay true. Stay true to the end. So listen. Whether you're just starting your Christian life, you're in the middle of your Christian life, you're struggling with finishing, you know, faith all the way. Because that's how the just shall live. Galatians 2:20, the Bible says, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. So faith is how we live. 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, so walk by faith and not by sight. So faith is our walk. Faith is our talk. Faith is our life. In fact, that's how to die. No other way to die than in faith. Amen. Bible says these all died in faith. Amen. So we die in faith too. Yeah, it says they didn't receive the promise. Why didn't they receive it? It wasn't for their day, but it was for us. And thank God we can experience those things. Amen. So faith is how we live. Faith is how we finish our course. And like we said, one thing about faith is this. There's a fight to it. There's a fight to it. There's a fight to faith. Now, if there's a fight to faith, that immediately tells me there are enemies to faith. Now, when people think about the enemies to faith, where our minds go to is pretty interesting. You know, God never told the Christian to fight sin. Now, understand how I mean that. You know, in Hebrews 12, 3, the Bible talks about striving, resisting unto blood in striving against sin. Hebrews 12, 3 and 4. Don't be faint and waving your mind. We're to stand against sin. That's not what I'm not saying otherwise. But when I say the Bible says not to fight sin, there are many Christians struggling with sin. Stop it. Jesus already fought sin for us and conquered it. So there's no sin problem today. There's only a sinner problem. If you bring the sinner to Jesus, Jesus will rid him of his sin nature. So sin is not the object. You know, if you're, imagine, I heard this story of a fellow who was about to write an exam, Christian religious knowledge. And one question in the exam was to write about the life and times of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I don't know whether it's fact or fiction, but I heard this story. And the guy responds and says, who am I to talk about the whole Jesus, the savior of the world, the creator of the universe? I'm not even worthy to unloose the latchet of the soles of the feet of his forerunner. He said, I'd rather talk about his forerunner. So he's talked about John the Baptist. Maybe he didn't read about Jesus, but he read about John, you know. And he did such an excellent job talking about John the Baptist. Now, no matter how good he was at it, you know, he failed the exam. He may just as well have marked it himself and put zero
Olodu upon 20. You know, he scored zero. In fact, he may have even scored worse than zero. The person marking could have gotten so angry that he would have taken some of his marks from the other questions he may have gotten right. So he may have even gotten minus 5. Are you listening? The point there is this. Because he's writing the wrong, he's answering the wrong question. No matter how well he answers it, he'll fail. Now, some people are in the wrong fight. No matter how well they fight it, they will fail. Because that's not the fight where to fight. You know, some people, their orientation towards Christianity is when they wake up in the morning. How will I not lie today? How will I not sleep around today? How will I not cheat today? How will I not do wrong today? How will I not do wrong? My guy, stop that thing. Why are you not thinking about how will I get people born again today? How will I be a blessing to somebody today? How will I be faithful and do good to someone? Amen. So rather than being so sin conscious, we ought to be righteousness conscious. And the Bible says, awake to righteousness and sin not. So it's not sin that we're to fight. Romans 8:3 says, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh. God sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. Verse 4 says that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh but after the spirit. Now I like that Romans 8:3 in the Amplified Classic. It says that God condemned, subdued, overcame, and deprived sin of its power over all those who accept the sacrifice of his son. So why do you want to fight something that's already conquered? Jesus conquered sin for us. That's Romans 8:3 in the Amplified Classic. He conquered it for us. Are you listening to me? He conquered it for us. So we don't need to fight it. Some other people, it's Satan they are trying to fight. Why in the world would you want to fight him? In your strength, you can't whip him. You can't match him. Besides, he's already defeated. Jesus defeated him for us. Colossians 2:15 says, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. So why do I want to fight someone who's defeated? Jesus defeated the devil. Jesus brought him to naught. And he did it in my stead. He did it in my place. 1 John 4:4 says, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them. Talking about Satan and all his cohorts. Now, why have we overcome them? Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So we're not to fight sin. We're not to fight Satan. Then what are we to fight? The good fight of faith. Now, if there's a fight to faith, there are enemies to faith. What are those enemies? I'll tell you. All the enemies in the fight of faith, they really hinge on two things. The first is a lack of knowledge of the Word of God. A lack of knowledge of the Word of God. I can tell you, and I can tell you free of charge, if there's any area in your life that you are struggling, you lack knowledge in that area. If you are struggling in your finances, you lack knowledge of God's Word about finances. If you are struggling in your health, you lack knowledge of God's word about healing and health. If you're struggling with bad habits, you know, struggling with the flesh, you lack knowledge of the word of God in that area. That's why. So Romans 10:17 tells us that, so then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. See, the measure of your faith is actually the measure of your knowledge of your father and of your rights and privileges in his family. See, faith is the concomitant of knowledge. Faith is the concomitant of knowledge. Faith comes to the heart unconsciously through the door of discovered evidence. There's no effort whatsoever on the part of the intellect or the will of man to get faith. As soon as the light of God's word comes in, faith is there. Psalm 119 verse 130. The entrance of thy words giveth light. It giveth understanding to the simple. New American Standard Version says, the unfolding of your word brings understanding. You see, when the light of God's word comes to your spirit, faith will be there. Faith will be there. Faith follows light. Faith follows light. Let me tell you something. If you're born again, you really don't have a faith problem. You may have a knowledge problem. You may not be feeding your faith, but you see, you have the ability to believe. That's what we are. We're believers. We're believers. We believe. But the problem is this. If you don't know God's word, your faith will struggle because you are not feeding it. Yes, you have the capacity to believe the word of God, but you need to know the word. If you don't know God's word, then there's nothing for you to believe. So the primary thing is knowledge. God said in Hosea chapter 4 verse 6, he said, my people. He didn't say the devil's people. He said his own people, my people, God's people. He said, are destroyed. Yeah, I was talking about these people under the old covenant, but it applies to his people of all time. My people are destroyed. Why? Because of the lack of knowledge. In Isaiah 5:13, said, my people are gone into captivity. Why? Because they have no knowledge. So knowledge is vital. Knowledge of the word. In John 8:31 and 32, the Bible says, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. So knowledge of God's word. Knowledge of God's word. And that's why we need to study. That's why we need to come to church regularly. Amen. That's why we need to take notes. Because the paper never forgets. Amen. Feed on the word. Build the word of God into your spirit. Read the Bible for yourself. Read it every day. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. So feed on the word. Build the word of God into your spirit. F.F. Bosworth is the author of the classic Christ the Healer. He was an outstanding healing evangelist, lived to be 80 plus. Now, Bosworth said something. He said, most Christians feed their spirits one cold snack a week and feed their bodies three hot meals a day. Said, and they then wonder why they are so weak in faith. P.C. Nelson said this. He said, constantly feed along the lines of faith and healing. Said, because the day will come when you will either need faith for your own healing or for the healing of a loved one. And if your faith has not been kept strong in that area, you will be at a disadvantage. Smith Wigglesworth put it like this. He said, if you wait until you need faith and then try to get it, you may have waited too late. Are you listening? Feed your faith. The word of God is faith food. Matthew 4:4 says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. What's God saying? That what bread or physical food is to the body, that's what the word of God is to our spirits. The word of God is the food of faith. So feed your faith on the word. Feed your faith on the word. Feed your faith on the entire counsel of God's word. In 2 Timothy 3:16-17, the Bible says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto every good work. So all scripture is inspired, and it's going to take all scripture for the man of God to be thoroughly furnished. Are you listening? Yes, sir. Old Testament, New Testament, all of it. But pay particular attention to the New Testament, because we're in the New Covenant now, right? And then in the New Testament, especially the epistles, because the epistles are the letters written to the church. So feed your faith. Get to know who you are in Christ. Get to understand that you are the righteousness of God. Get to understand that you're a new creature in Christ Jesus. Get to understand that you have an actual redemption from the devil's dominion. Get to understand who Christ has made you. When you know those things, you see, sin does not have dominion over me. It doesn't. It can't. Why? Because the day I took Jesus as my Savior and confessed him as my Lord, Satan's dominion over me ended. Disease's dominion over me ended. Colossians 1:13, I was delivered from the dominion of darkness and translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son, same as you. Amen. So get knowledge of the word. So I said, in the fight of faith, two things. First is knowledge, a lack of knowledge of the word. The second, it's just like, you see, to walk properly, I need two legs, right? Trying to walk on one leg is going to be a struggle. God gave us two. So, two legs. One leg is knowledge. The other leg is action. You see, what you know will do you no good except you act on it. It's knowledge acted upon that produces results. See, what's faith actually? Faith is just acting on the word of God. Faith is acting like the Bible is true because you know it's true. It's just that you can't act on what you don't know. So you need to know it. You need to know it. You need to build persuasion. Now, I see people many times trying to act on the word without building that word into their spirits. They're just trying to act out of their head, or maybe trying to act based on somebody else's testimony. You know, somebody gives a testimony, God did this for them, they did this. Usually, that's the abridged version. You didn't hear everything.
Yes, sir.
Are you listening?
Yes, sir.
Besides, they acted based on persuasion. The first thing is not trying to do what they did. The first thing is go and build the word into your own heart and build persuasion. In Hebrews 11:29, the Bible says, by faith, the children of Israel, they passed through the Red Sea as of a dry land, which the Egyptians are saying to do were drowned. See, when Israel left Egypt, started towards their homeland, Canaan, they got to the Red Sea. Then Moses began to cry to God, what do we do here? God told Moses, stretch forth your rod, you know, go forward. Well, what did he do? He acted on what God told him. And then the sea parted. Now, the Egyptians trying to recapture them saw some people acting on God's word. Then they acted on those people's action. And you know the rest of the story. They died. Don't just act on somebody else's action. Do you have the same revelation the person has? Do you have the same relationship with God the person has? The same fellowship with God the person has? So, the first thing to do is to find out what the word of God says. Take the time to meditate on scriptures. Many times I meet people, they claim to be believing for something, believing for a spouse, believing for healing, believing for a job, believing for whatever else. Then I ask them, what scripture are you standing on? And then they become stammerers overnight. MMM, MMM, MMM. You see, MMM failed. Leave it alone. Are you listening? Yeah. What scripture are you standing on? Find scripture that covers your case. Faith begins where the will of God is known. And the word of God is the will of God. Scripture rightly divided. Find a scripture that covers that case. You need healing. Isaiah 53, 4 and 5. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. Matthew 8, 17. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. 1 Peter 2:24, whose own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we being dead to sins should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. See, 1 Peter 2:24 is not a promise, it's a statement of fact. God did not promise to heal you, he healed you. Yes, he promised to heal us in the Old Testament. Talking about redemption that was to come. Redemption has come. So our healing is a fact now. Yes, it's a promise in the sense of, we talk about God's word, his promises, in the sense of his provisions. According as his divine powers given to us, all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue, whereby giving unto us exceeding great and precious promises. 2 Peter 1, 3 and 4. So yes, in a sense, it's a promise. But it's not a promise in the sense of God is going to do it. He has done it. You say, if God has done it, why am I still sick? Because you haven't taken your healing. Why is this healing taking so long to manifest? Why is this healing taking so long to show up? It's you we should ask, not God. Hey, but I'm waiting for God's time. My guy, keep quiet. God's time was 2,000 years ago. You see, there are certain things that have God's timing. When it comes to the plan and the purpose of God. But even with that, it's more in phases. And how soon you step into the next phase, many times is dependent on how faithful you are in this phase. Are you listening? But when it comes to God's provisions, you've been married. You're waiting for God's time to have children. So that when you're 80, you will now be time pampers. Stop that rubbish. The Bible talks about the wife of your youth. God doesn't want you to marry at age 80 or at age 75. The wife of your youth. Somebody, God wants you to be the wife of somebody's youth. Not the wife of their old age. Are you listening? Yeah, when it comes to the things that belong to us already in Christ, when we experience them, has more to do with us than anybody else. Is when you take it. Yes, there's usually a time gap between the time you believe that you receive it and the time you get it. But how short that time is, depends on how well developed your faith is. Are you listening to me? So, knowledge of the word. But then don't stop at that. Act on it. It's knowledge acted upon that produces results. It's knowledge acted upon that produces results. It's not what you know that counts. It's what you do with it. James 1:22 says, "Well, be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves." So if you just hear the word, you don't do it, you're going to be self-deluded. You know, there's one condition called manic depressive illness. When people are on the manic side, doctors say they have delusions of grandeur. Grandiose delusion. They are deceived. Don't deceive yourself. How will we not deceive ourselves? By doing the word of God, doing what we know. Matthew 7:24-27. "Whoso heard these sayings of mine and doeth them," Jesus said, "I likened him unto a wise man who built his house upon a rock. The floods came, the winds blew, beat upon the house. It fell not, for it was founded upon a rock." He said, "Whoso heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not, I will liken him unto a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. The floods came, the winds blew, beat upon the house, it fell, and great was the fall thereof." Let me tell you something. Believe God for bigger things. The more you feed your faith and exercise it, the more it grows. Many times we've compassed some mountains long enough. It's time to move northward. It's time to go forward. Let's even have bigger challenges. All those KK problems, let's leave them for the young boys. All those yamanyama challenges, you should have outgrown that now. Let's face bigger problems. No, not these small ones. Are you listening to me? Yeah. Let your faith engage greater challenges. God will do for us as much as we dare to believe him for. It's as much as you dare. Many times, we don't stretch our faith. And because we don't stretch it, we don't know its capacity. Believe God. Believe God. Start where you are at in your faith and keep using it. Primary way we act is by speaking. Is by speaking. If you really believe, you will act. Primary action of faith is to speak. 2 Corinthians 4:13. "We have in the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak." What do you say? What are you saying? Are you saying the same thing the word of God says about you? You know, the Bible says that when they say there's a casting down, we say there's a lifting up. The Bible says in famine and in destruction, we shall laugh. The Bible says, "My God supplies all my need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." The Bible says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." So that's what I should say. That's how I should talk. You know, there's no money. You know, things are bad. As things are bad, some people became billionaires this year. As things are bad, some people, they moved into their own house this year. As things are bad, some people brought brand new car this year. Leave story for storytellers. I beg, leave that thing. "My God shall supply all your need, not according to the economy of your country, not according to the economy of the world at that time, according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." It says, "Thou shalt guide me with thy counsel, and afterward receive me up into glory." The glory world, that's heaven. Amen. The cattle on 1,000 hills belong to your Father. The silver and the gold belong to him. The earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof. The world and they that dwell therein. What belongs to God belongs to us. Amen. Amen. Psalm 84 verse 11. "The Lord God is a sun and a shield. He will give grace and glory. No good thing shall he withhold from them that walk uprightly." Isaiah 1:19. "If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. Drive the good of the land. Wear the good of the land." Now, let me also say this. See, prosperity in God is not overnight. Start where you are at. Be faithful there. Be diligent. God will bless the work of your hands. Are you listening? Yes. Do something. No matter the blessing you carry, if you don't give that blessing opportunity to manifest, it is just a potential blessing. And there's potential energy. There's kinetic energy. Some people's blessing is potential. Some people will die with tremendous potential. The place where the greatest potential you'll find is in the grave. Tremendous. They died with it. Yeah. Act. Big be say. Take steps. Take steps. Take steps. Take action. Dare to do big things. Start something. You know, some people are looking for, I'm looking for work. You've been looking for work now 4 years. My guy, you give work to people. What do you have? You see, nature never made a failure. God's plan. You see, when it was time for God to use Moses to take them out of Egypt, he asked Moses, what was that in your hand? A rod. He threw it on the ground. It became snake. He used that rod to part the Red Sea. That rod became rod of God. When it was time, and there was Goliath, you know, and they were giving David they were giving him Saul's armor. See, I haven't proved it. But he had a sling in his neck. He used his slingshot, took him down. That was what he had. When the wine finished, Jesus said, what do you have? He said, they have water. He said, fill the pots with water. Take it to the governor of the feast. It became wine. When it was time, the multitude, they were hungry. He said, what do you have? They had 5 loaves, 2 fish. He blessed it. He broke it. Gave it to the multitude. He fed over 5,000, 12 baskets extra. God always uses what you have. Many times, people overlook what they have. And they are looking at what somebody else has. There's something you have. There's a skill you have. You know, I met some people. They've been looking for a job. Some of these people, when it comes to clothes, the way they are with clothes, I tell some of them, why don't you sell clothes? They feel like, clothes, will that get you anywhere? Ah, the way you are with clothes, the way you match colors, the way you are with shoes, sell the shoes. You know that business. You understand it. You hear some of them, they'll say, you see, this one was made in such and such. The way some people know perfumes. Someone will pass, they say, the perfume he's wearing is this. And I will say, that perfume, sell perfume. You will make money. You know it. There's something you have. Upskill. Get something. Learn something. See, some people, they're coming to ask someone else for money. The phone they are carrying, the person they are asking for money, doesn't have it. Why don't you sell that phone and start something? Yes, start something. When you start that thing, you will buy more phones. You see, if you are not ready to inconvenience yourself today because of your comfort, you will never have it tomorrow. The people that have glorious futures are the people that are ready. Muhammad Ali was heavyweight champion of the world. He got the title back. You know, he had it 3 times. He was arguably one of the most outstanding athletes of the century. Some say he was the greatest athlete of the century. Ali said, he said, suffer today and enjoy tomorrow. The way he will train, he will run around the stadium. He will wait until he's tired. When he's tired, he will start counting. Yes. You say, I ran around 50 times. It was 50 times after I got tired. He said, because I know they will punch me. They will punch me hard. I will meet some of those hard guys who are strong. I'll meet people stronger than I am. Let me train for that day. See, that's the way life is. Suffer today and enjoy tomorrow. Now, I'm not talking about suffering, poverty, suffering, like, I mean, sacrifice today. Discipline yourself today. When you feel like quitting, look at the joy set before you. Look at the joy set before you. Say, So faith. Live by faith. Feed on the word. Put the word of God to practice with words and actions. Second thing, if you are going to finish strong, we must walk in love. We must walk in love. Love is the law of the family of God. Are you listening to me? In John 13, 34 and 35, Jesus said a new commandment. Notice he didn't say a new suggestion. A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another. As I've loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. Love is the law of the family of God. Love is the law of the new creation. See, I'm strong on faith. I should be. All Christians should be. But I tell you something, I'm stronger on love. Love is faith's power. Love is faith's energizer. Galatians 5:6 says faith works by love. See, the more you know a person loves you, the easier it is to trust them. So, faith works. The more I understand God's love for me, the easier it becomes to trust him. Then there's a flip side to that coin. See, that same love that God has towards me is now in me. And God also wants to love other people through me. Are you listening? If I don't act on that love, I'm going to give my faith a hard time. Jesus, Mark 11, 23 and 24, classic text on faith. He went in verse 25, and when ye stand praying, forgive if ye have aught against any. that your Father also, which is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses. Said, but if ye do not forgive, now will your Father in heaven forgive you. What's Jesus saying, basically? Unforgiveness will hinder your faith. It will hinder your prayers. If I had a choice between a rattlesnake and unforgiveness, I'll choose the rattlesnake. Very poisonous snake, but unforgiveness is more poisonous. Unforgiveness will ruin you, destroy you, mar your spiritual life, cause you to die young, cause you to be sick, cause you to be broke, will destroy everything. See, they've already hurt you. Don't let them hurt you more. Let it go. How am I going to overcome the evil they did to me by doing them good back? The Bible says, don't be overcome of evil. How do you not get overcome by the evil they did to you? By doing good. Overcome evil with good. See, the way to heal from that hurt is to forgive the person that hurt you. Matthew 5:44, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you. Pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you. Now, if you begin to curse me, I'll bless you. If you hate me, I'll love you. If you do me evil, I'll do you good. If you speak evil of me, I'll speak good of you. I'm just going to walk in love. Love is God's way, is my way. Love never fails. Love never fails. Love never fails. There are times it looks like you got the short end of the stick. It's a lie. You will win out in the end. Ephesians 4:32 says, be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. How did God forgive us? Because we deserved it? No. You see, whether they repent or they don't repent, that's their problem. Yeah, they may need to repent for there to be a reconciliation. That's a fact. But whether they repent or they don't repent, I forgive them. I forgive them not because of them. I forgive them because of me and because of God. Because that's my nature. And I just refuse to dwell on it. Now, there's an aspect of walking in love I want to particularly emphasize, and it's this. Galatians 5:13 says that God has called us to liberty. Said, but don't use your liberty as an occasion to the flesh, but by love, serve one another. You see, if I'm walking in love, I'll be willing to serve other people. I'll be willing to bless other people. You know, there are some people who are members of this church, and they are Sunday, Sunday, Melissing. You know, I don't hear of their premier anymore. You know, they are Sunday, Sunday Christians. They are seat warmers. Ask yourself, if everybody gives to this church like I give to this church, will there have been a service this morning? If everybody serves in this church as I serve in this church, will there still be a church? Rather than asking yourself, what can this church do for me? Why don't you ask yourself, what can I do for my church? Ask yourself a question. What value am I adding? What value? What's the value I'm adding? I'll tell you something. In a church, you don't know who the greatest giver is. That's the truth. The widow gave 2 mites. Jesus said she gave more than everybody else. Out of the abundance they gave, she gave everything she had of her lack. Are you listening? So it's not so much of what you give, as much as after you gave it, what did you have left? It's in proportion to what you have. Somebody can give 10 million and it was stingy. Because maybe they should have given 100. And it could have been very stingy. Another person could have given 10,000 and they give very generously. You know, sometimes in talking about giving, you know, you can give without loving. But you can't love without giving. And if you give without loving, it won't profit you. 1 Corinthians 13:3. You can give a lot, but if the motive is wrong, it won't profit you. That's why many people don't get harvest from a lot of giving, because their motive was wrong. But you can't love without giving. If you really love, you will give. Are you listening? Yeah, we should cater for the poor. We should cater for the less privileged. We should give to our parents. You should give to your pastors. You know, some people are saying, tell them, oh, they should give to the poor. They should give to we poor. Stop that rubbish. You are not the poor. Tell your neighbor, I'm not the poor. Tell another neighbor, I'm not the poor. Say to yourself, I'm not the poor. So when some people hear give to the poor, I say, hey, tell them more. It's not them I'm telling, it's you. You see, even if you are down in life, give your way out of it. There's something you have. You say, but I don't have any money. You have a smile. I don't have anything. You have a handshake. I don't have anything. You have your time. The truth is, we all have something. Give your way out of lack. Serve your way out of being small. The way to become great is to serve. Is to serve. You know, they were arguing, I want to sit on your right hand, I want to sit on your left hand. He said, look, that's how Jesus told them. That's how they do in the world. With us, it's not like that. He that will be great among you must be your servant. So there is a heart that just wants to serve. A heart that just wants to bless. A heart that just wants to give. What can I do in church? Are you in a team? Are you in a department? Are you doing something? What are you doing? Look, it doesn't cost to serve God. It pays off. The Bible says, if they will obey and serve him, serve him, serve him. Job 36:11. They will spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasures. Exodus 23:25-26 says, and ye shall serve, serve, serve the Lord thy God, and he will bless thy bread and thy water. Said, I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. There shall none cast their young nor be barren in thy land. The number of thy days I will fulfill. Let me tell you something. We are God's sons. We don't earn his blessings, right? They are our rights and privileges because we are his sons. But listen, because faith works by love, you can't get God's best if you don't give him your best. That's a fact. You see, I'll tell you something. People often ask, what is God doing in these last days? I'll tell you and I'll tell you for free. He's building strong local churches. And he's teaching them to flow in the supernatural. God is strong about the local church. God is strong about the local church. Get plugged in into your local church. Hebrews 10:25. Not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, so much the more as ye see the day approaching. You see, some assembly is required. Not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together. Thank God for online. I can't hug you online. You can give emoji. You see, if you are looking down, you are going through a trial. We can't see it online. But when we see your face, what happened? You've lost weight. What's going on? Then we know what's happening to you. Are you listening to me? What am I doing to bless somebody else? What am I doing to help somebody else? It can't all be about me. You know that ungodly trinity, me, myself, and I. What is in it for me? What is in it for me? What is in it for me? No, what is in it for the other person? How can I be a blessing to the other person? How can I be a blessing to the church? You are pastors. Your pastors are blessed people. But I tell you, there's a Bible principle. The Bible says, not to muzzle the ox that treads out the corn. The laborer is worthy of his hire. You see, but they are blessed. Now, that's talking about the office of the pastor, particularly your pastor. I'm a guest minister. Small time now, I will carry my kaya, I'll be gone. When you need counsel, you won't even find my number. It's your pastor's. When you need help, it's your pastor's. When you need to be taught, it's your pastor's. When you need to be prayed for, it's your pastor's. You say, no, it's pastor that should give to me. That's why you are broke. And that's why you stay broke if you don't fix it. You say, but what can I give? You see that 100 naira recharge card? If that's all you can give, give it. How about saying, pastor, you won't buy rice. All the rice you'll be eating will come from me. See, Christmas will soon be around the corner. How about giving your pastor a good hamper? What can you do? You can do something. There's something you have. Start there. Be a blessing to somebody else. Okay, you're married. Don't let it just be about what I can get from my spouse. How about what can you give to them? How can you be a blessing to them? Put the other person first. Put the other person's interest first. God should come first. The other person should be next, and you should put yourself last. You can never go under doing that. So, talking about finishing strong, right? Want to finish this year strong? Believe God. Something you are still trusting God for. The year is not done yet. Go back to the scriptures you are standing on. Continue to meditate in them. Continue to speak the word of God. I am expectant. It shall come to pass. And thank God, he will bring you to pass. And make sure you're walking in love. You don't permit bitterness. You don't permit grudges. You don't permit unforgiveness. And sometimes the only way you can forgive is by faith. Forgiveness is not a feeling, it's a decision. It's a decision. Start praying for the person. As you continue to pray for, it's difficult for me to hold something against you when I'm praying for you. As I start praying for you, God will touch my heart. And then he will start talking to me specifically about what I need to do to be a blessing to you. Amen. Number three, if you are going to finish strong, maintain a prayer life. Maintain a prayer life. Are you listening to me? Maintain a prayer life. You see, the plan of God for our life, we pray it out. In 1 Corinthians 14:2, the Bible says, "For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understandeth him, howbeit in the spirit he speaketh mysteries." The future is a mystery. Only one person knows it, and that's God. Yes, you may have some idea about the future based on some things God told you or based on certain projections, but the future can change. Is God, is only God that knows the future for a fact. But you see, we can pray out that future. We can pray it out in other tongues. Pray out the plan. Pray out the purpose of God. See, why is it important to pray about the future? There are some things about the future that are not in your own hands. There are some things about your destiny that lies with other people. You see, money is in the hands of people. If you want money, build strong relationships. Resources are in people's hands. There are things that maybe it's government policy. A policy can come from the government that can make a billionaire become nothing in 1 week. And a policy can come that can take a man from prison to the palace the same day. Just one pronouncement. Are you listening to me? That's why it's important to pray out the future. Pray out the plan of God. As this year is wrapping up, let's take time out to start praying out the future for next year. You could even add some fasting. Fasting doesn't change God. It changes us. It helps us to keep the body under. God is the same before we fast, when we fast, after we fast. But it helps us. You know, I know we have a Gunje culture in Nigeria. Setu, setu, setu. We shouldn't carry that same setu culture into fasting. No. It's not God that we're fasting for. It's ourselves. To help us keep our flesh under so that we're more sensitive to spiritual things and we can hear God more clearly and devote more time. The time you will have spent eating, this time you will have spent on Facebook, the time you will have spent watching TV, spend that extra time seeking God, feeding on his word, waiting on him, praying in the spirit. Pray out the plan. Pray out the plan. Pray out the plan. Ephesians 6:18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Pray out the purpose of God for your life. There's a lot that is in the future. Pray it out. And finally, number four, if you want to finish strong, be led by the Holy Ghost. Be led by the Holy Ghost. See, there is a race God has set before you. Hebrews 12:1-2. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and now is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. 1 Corinthians 9:24-27. I therefore run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. Says, but run that ye may obtain. Says, and everyone that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Says, they do it to get a corruptible crown, but we are an incorruptible. He now said in verse 26, I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. 27 says, but I keep under my body. I bring it into subjection. You can't be led by your flesh if you want to finish strong. We must be led by the Spirit of God. We must learn to keep our bodies under. There is a race God has set before you. It is your race. You know one thing I found out? If I want the full dimension of God's approval, all I need is the full dimension of his plan. See, many times we make our plan and then we take it to God and ask him to bless it. He looks at us and he shakes his head. If we go to him and get his plan, he's already blessed. He's already blessed. He's already blessed. He's already blessed. Being led by the Spirit of God. And how does the Spirit of God lead us? Just a witness in our hearts. Yes, I've had visions. Yes, I've had dreams. Yes, I've heard the audible voice of the Holy Ghost. Not too many times, but I've heard it a number of times in my life. Remember the very first time? It was January. It was August. August 20, 1989. It was a Sunday. About 4:30, I had this voice, loud and clear, something about the future. You know? I actually said, who said that? I looked under the bed. I opened the wardrobe. Oh, then I remembered. That must have been what Samuel heard. So yes, God can speak to us like that. But really, I'll tell you something. Anytime God has spoken to me spectacularly, usually there was trouble ahead. I've seen angels come to give me direction. I've had things like that. But I'll tell you something. I just love that in word witness. When I start having those other ones, hey, my heart starts doing like, oh God, why are you leading me so spectacularly? Usually it's because there's trouble and he wants me to stay steady. So the inward witness is okay. It's okay. Yes, if God wants us to guide us spectacularly, that's fine. But many times we seek the spectacular and we miss the supernatural. The inward witness is just as supernatural as guidance through a vision. Romans 8:14 says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Verse 16 says, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. You know, sometimes you're thinking about doing something and you're praying about it. And the more you think about doing it and pray about it, you just have an uneasiness on the inside. You just have a dead feeling. You just have a hesitancy. A red light. Okay, there's this girl. You're thinking, is this the babe? The girl is sad. See how she's sad. You know, you're thinking on those things. She's the kind of, just the way I want them. You know, thank God for that. Beauty is skin deep. It's only skin deep, you know, and it's in the eye of the beholder. Well, God gave Job the most beautiful daughters in the land. So God knows beauty. But listen, some things are more important. Beauty has its place. Don't marry someone you don't find attractive. But listen, what is God saying? You know, some people, their only prayer point is Jackpot. Canada, Canada, where's your face? Where's your face? Canada, Canada, UK, here I come. USA. Hey, this one that Trump has won. You know, that's what some people are saying. That Canada, it'd be like, say, that one at the thing. You know, that's all some people are thinking about. Let me tell you something. Prosperity is not a citizen of the abroad, though. And poverty is not a citizen of Nigeria. The safest place, the most prosperous place to be, is in the center of God's will for your life. You know, there are people who are washing toilets in Canada. There are people who are doing gate man in UK, who are living well here. But they don't jackpot. Pa don't jar them. Yes. Are you listening to me? Be led of God. Be led of God. Go by what you have on the inside. Go by what you have on the inside. Don't go by how it looks. Don't go by how it seems. Don't go by your senses. Yes, I have common sense. Good too. When I wake up in the morning, I don't check my spirit whether I should brush my teeth. Common sense tells me I should. I don't check my spirit whether I should have my bath. Common sense tells me I should. Yeah, I need good rest. I need good exercise. Common sense tells me that. But you see, when it comes to the plan of God, the purpose of God, don't go with common sense. Go with the witness on the inside of you. Some other times you're thinking about doing something and praying about it. And the more you think about it and pray about it, especially when you pray in tongues, you just have a good feeling on the inside. Like a gentle push. It just seems good. So I should go in this direction. You're just getting excited on the inside of you. And it persists. It persists. Especially when you pray in other tongues and you spend time in the Word. It persists, then go ahead. You can never miss out following that witness. Somebody told me one time, he said, when I look at your life, I tell myself that it's either God leads you or you're a genius. I said, I don't know about the latter part, but I endeavor to follow the leading of God. He will lead you into God's perfect will. Who just be at the right place at the right time with the right people doing the right things. Amen. Heavenly Father, thank you for reminding us about finishing and finishing strong. We know that's your will for us not just to be good starters, but also to be strong finishers, to finish strong. Thank you for reminding us about the need to live by faith, to walk in love, to pray much in the Spirit, to pray out the plan, pray out your purpose, and to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. We'll put these things to practice. We'll do your will. Now, peradventure, there's anybody under the sound of my voice today, young man, young woman, boy or girl, tall or short, light or dark, who doesn't know Jesus as his Lord and personal Savior? Look, if you're going to finish strong, it starts from you starting there, receiving Jesus into your heart. He loves you just as you are. And like Pastor said, the plans, the thoughts that he has towards you are thoughts of good and not evil, to give you a future and a hope. So if you don't know the Lord Jesus, or you once knew the Lord, but you've been out of fellowship with him, and you want to get back in fellowship with him, could you just lift up your hand where you are? He said, thank you, my sister, for that hand. Just lift up your hand where you are. He said, he that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast him out. Thank you, my sister, for that other hand. Any other person said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. If you'll deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Now, if you lifted your hand, wanted to lift up your hand, should have lifted your hand, still thinking of lifting your hand, I want you to take another step. Come and join me right here. I want to pray with you and pray for you. Just come forward. Amen. Forget about what anybody thinks. You want to receive Jesus into your heart, or you had received him in the past, but you're out of fellowship with God, and you want to get back in fellowship. Look, today is the day of salvation. Now is the acceptable time. Today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. Come and join me. Come and join me. Amen. Forget about what people will think or what they won't think. That's their problem. It's between you and the Lord. Amen. Come forward. Come forward. Come forward. Just stand up where you are. Amen. Just stand up where you are. Come and join me here. I want to pray with you and pray for you. Amen. Amen. Come and join me. Come and join me. Yeah. Forget about what anybody thinks. Forget about what anybody thinks. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. If I were given $1 million, if it's $1 million I'm offering, you won't care who sees you. You say, I beg. When you are spending your money, nobody will, you say, if you like, make fun of me. Now you sabi, I will enjoy my money by myself. Yeah, it's between you and God. Anybody else, you want to join them. You want to join them. Yeah, come, come, come. It won't hurt. I won't bite you. Don't be afraid. Amen. Praise God. Want to join them? Just come forward. You say, if you know my life, whatever your life is, he said, he that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast him out. Amen. So just come, 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 come. He's the husband to the bride, the friend to the friendless, the compass to the traveler. Amen. Anybody else, you want to join them? Okay, let me ask you a question. Are you receiving Jesus for the first time, or you had received him in the past, or you want to rededicate your life? Which one is it? Rededicate. Same thing. All right. We pray differently with such people. So just say this and mean it. Say with me, Father, I'm your daughter. I'm your child. In the past, I received Jesus as my Lord and personal Savior, believing in my heart that you raised him from the dead. So I know I'm born again. But I haven't been walking in fellowship with you like I should. I repent of that. I ask that you forgive me for the things I did in broken fellowship. Thank you for cleansing me from all unrighteousness. Thank you because I will walk with you. I will do your will. You are able to make me stand, and I will stand in Jesus' name. Now do something. Can you see this handsome brother right here? Just go with him. Why are we saying that? So the church can follow up with you. Amen. Now let me tell you one thing. I want to pray for the sick. I want to pray for the sick. Listen to me. To finish strong, you need a healthy body. Are you listening to me? And God's will is that you live a long life, a healthy long life. Amen. I will lay hands on you in the name of Jesus. No matter the sickness, no matter the disease, it will go. See, June the 1st of 1992, Jesus appeared to me. He caught me up to heaven. He laid his right hand on my head. He said to me, he said, I've called you specially and anointed you specially to do what I've called you to do. Among other things, I minister with a tangible anointing of healing power. If you will believe that I'm anointed and you will receive that anointing, that power will flow from my hands into your body. It will drive out whatever sickness or disease, and it will effect a healing and a cure in you. I've seen people bound by habits, drugs, lust, all kinds of things. People bound by demon activity. I laid hands on them in the name of Jesus with the power of God. And that was the end of the sickness. That was the end of the addiction. Listen to me. The power of God is present here this morning, and it will make you whole. If you'd like to be ministered to with the laying on of hands for healing, amen, or deliverance from whatever, could you just put up a hand where you are? Just put up a hand where you are. You want hands laid on you. Thank you. Yeah, anybody else? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. There's someone who you have a pain on your lower abdomen, the left side. Yeah, the power of God is already touching you. Praise God. Now, those who put up their hands, just come forward. I lay hands on you in the name of Jesus, and you will be healed. You will be healed. This is your day. This is your day. This is your day. This is your day. As you're coming out, say with me, this is my day. This is my day. I'm taking my healing today. I'm taking my deliverance today. I'm taking my freedom today. Today, as hands are laid on me, I am made whole. Yeah, and I can tell you that for a fact, that this is your day. Amen. Amen. Father, you're a good father. Thank you for your healing power. I lay my hands on these ones in obedience to the head of the church, the Lord Jesus, and the law of contact and transmission. The contact of my hands transmitting God's healing power into their bodies. It will undo that which the enemy has done. It will effect a healing and a cure in them. In Jesus' name. Yeah, in the name of Jesus. That's it. In the name of Jesus. That's it. In the name of Jesus. Once hands have been laid on you, you could go back to your seat. In the name of Jesus. And just go rejoicing. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We are made whole. Amen. 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 In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Be healed. Be healed. In Jesus' name. Be set free from the shackle of the enemy. In the name of Jesus. The name of Jesus. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. If you had hands laid on you, say with me, hands were laid on me. Say it again. Hands were laid on me. The power of God came on me. It's working in me. In Jesus' name. Amen. That's it. Yeah, I actually felt that power go into his body. Praise God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Begin to do what you couldn't do before. Begin to check your body. Amen. You'll see that you're already recovering. And some of you are already made perfectly whole. Amen. Let's say together, I will finish strong. I will fight a good fight. I'll finish my course. I'll keep the faith. Do you believe that? Well, why not jump on your seat and give